My talk today is actually to get you to think about health, because sometimes we take health for granted, and when health isn't the way we want it to be, then we go to doctors. And actually, our body is designed to heal itself. And we have kind of lost access to that healing power because we have been taught a lot of things rather than us being able to connect to our instinct. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. And for those who came in late, I am the founder of SHARAN. SHARAN stands for Sanctuary for Health and Reconnection to Animals and Nature. And because I'm a doctor, I'm mainly dealing with the health aspect of it. So I conduct workshops about reversing diabetes and hypertension. That's what I was busy with in Bangalore over the weekend. But I just want to share with you, one of my first patients who inspired me to stop my practice and going into teaching people how to become their own best doctors so that they really don't need a doctor. And this was a 70-year-old woman in Pondicherry who had had heart disease for 3 years, so much so that it was even difficult to get out of bed. But when she came to me, she had just come out of ICU, 3 weeks of ICU, with a prescription one page long. And at that time, I was a homeopath, and she didn't want to take all these medicines. And so she wanted me to treat her. But I was also traveling a lot because I was teaching all over the world, and I was going to be away for 2.5 months. And so I said, I can't take on this case. It was too severe. And I suggested that I teach her everything about diet, and she take the help of a cardiologist to cut down the medications. By the time I came back in 2.5 months, which was our deal, that she would do as much as she could with food, and by the time I came back, if she wasn't well, I would treat her with homeopathy. By the time I came back and I saw her, it blew my mind, because she was off all the medications, only on 1/4 of one tablet. And when I asked her, why are you on this, because everything was fine, she said, because my cardiologist will leave me if I stop all the medicine. So it was basically only that, you know. But she was getting up at 4 a.m. to go for a walk. This was someone who couldn't get up. And she was going in the evening to the gym for 30 minutes. So I said, what am I doing treating patients with? I was always telling them about healthy eating and things like that, but most of them didn't listen. And I started realizing that the people who had one foot in the grave were the ones who were ready to listen to everything. And they were the ones who had, you know, gave me mind-blowing results. So I just want to share with you a video. The video is not very good because it was me in the clinic taking the video. But you can get an idea of what she was, and I'll show you a photograph of her today.
My weight has gone down because of this diet. And I walk every morning for 50 minutes. And I exercise for 45 minutes. And I feel good. I feel very good. I have a very active program in school. I do everything. I was really a mess when I came to you. I was very tired, remember?
I think the most important probably is that I stopped the tea and the coffee. Mm-hmm. I think that was giving me very false signals. Mm-hmm. I think because I'm a tremendous tea and coffee lover. Mm-hmm. Not tea so much as coffee. Mm-hmm. And I think that is a very important change in my life. I think I never used to eat, and I never felt hungry. Now I have a much more normal life, really. And now I feel I'm really out of it, and my medication is very little. So I don't think I have
a problem. She said very little because she doesn't.
So it's like now I feel more relaxed about what I have to do. I think before I was more pressured about, you know, especially when I used to get into the, you know, like the last 3 or 4 years when I was very tired and I had to go to school and I had
to. She's a kindergarten teacher.
It was a terrible strain on me. I mean, you can't believe what a strain it was. I couldn't even get out of the bed in the mornings.
So, and this is her now, you know? So, and this is 8 years later. So, there's been a big change in her just by changing the food that she eats. So, how to be healthy? Like, we all know it because we're born with these instincts. But, for example, if you have a car, how will you make sure that your car is in the best condition? What kind of fuel would you put in your car?
Most refined.
Most refined? Or petrol, right? If it was a petrol car, you'd put petrol and you wouldn't put diesel instead. And the same is with our body, that we, if we were to put only the right fuel in our body, it's really hard to get sick. And we're usually smart about the fuel that cars require. Or even if you had a lion, you know what kind of food to give the lion or what kind of food to give a cow. And you know that you can't give grass to a lion or meat to a cow because they won't function well. But when it comes to our own body, we often look after the car better than our body, right? So we just put anything into it. And we usually don't know what we need to put in our body just because we've been bombarded with so many things that we've lost the instinct. But if we want to solve a problem, we have to make that shift. And it's actually just about accessing your instincts. So I just want to talk about some of the common myths. There's so many that I could spend a day, but we'll take a few. Just to show that our body is always healing itself. So, for example, if you get a fracture, bones heal, given the right conditions. So if we put the bones together in a way that they can't move against each other, they will heal. But do you know that teeth are bones? Does anyone know that? So, when you get a cavity, what do? Drill and fill. Like, actually make the hole bigger and then fill, right? Now, isn't that strange? If bones can heal, that when we get cavities, we drill and fill. And why do we drill and fill? Kind of because everyone's doing it. Like, who really thought about another way to heal cavities? Or who really put two and two together, because we're not thinking along these lines, right? We brush our teeth every day. And actually brushing is not instinctual, because every mother runs around the kid for some time till the kid starts brushing. But once we get into a habit, it's hard to stop. And if I were to ask you, why do you brush your teeth every day? Perhaps you wouldn't have an answer, because we brush our teeth to prevent cavities, but still we get cavities despite brushing our teeth every day. So why are we brushing our teeth? I mean, if you think even further, what are we putting on the brush to brush our teeth? Something that we would never allow to go inside, and yet we don't hesitate to put it in our mouth every day. And what if some of those chemicals go in? I'm just saying, you know, there's so many things to think about that we often don't think about. Do you know about osteoporosis? Does anyone know what osteoporosis is? Good. So, what is osteoporosis for them?
So, it's a kind of arthritis.
It's a kind of bone weakness of the bone, or bone brittleness, because it's considered to be because of lack of calcium in the bones. And so, what do people who have osteoporosis usually do? Does anyone have an idea? Yes. They take loads of calcium and vitamin D and perhaps loads of milk.
Yeah.
And do they ever get well?
No.
Isn't it surprising that everyone who has osteoporosis goes and does the same thing, even though all of us know that it never makes us well? And interestingly enough, doctors will tell you that you should have more milk when you have osteoporosis. But all the people who had osteoporosis were the ones who were already drinking milk. In fact, osteoporosis is more common in the countries which have the highest milk consumption. And yet we're all doing the same thing just because doctors are telling us, and doctors don't have nutrition education. So come in, you can just, doctors don't have nutrition education, and then this whole thing goes on because there's some kind of comfort in doing what everybody does. And as I told you, Sharan's vision is a diabetes-free India. And our body should actually never get diabetes, but we can prevent and reverse diabetes. But when someone gets diabetes, they go to the doctor and get the same prescription they know that never cured anybody. And so people, when they get diabetes, also keep getting worse and worse. And the worst thing about diabetes are the complications. And this is true with heart disease and hypertension as well. And actually, you know, this heart disease depends on the kind of blood that's going around. And if one artery is blocked, do you think the other heart arteries will be far behind? Not really, because it's the same blood that, you know, yet we go for bypass surgery and then second bypass and third bypass because we don't change our eating habits. We also try all kinds of things to lose weight, like diets, right? And we count calories, and everyone knows that diets hardly work, because if you lose weight, you're thinking so much of food that by the time you get off the diet, but animals in nature are never overweight. So why is this only specific to our species? Right? And the main reason is, I was telling them before for those who came in later, is that we are the only species that don't really think about what fuel we put into our bodies. We know what to feed a lion, we know what to feed a cow, we know what fuel to put in our car, we don't know what fuel to put in our bodies. And there are all kinds of diets which tell you all kinds of things, but usually people don't get the result with those diets. Otherwise there would be one diet, right? We also have an idea that proteins are good for health. And sometimes we try to eat more proteins. Even mothers might put soy atta in the wheat atta to give their children more protein. But that's another thing that we do without really thinking, because how many of you know someone with protein deficiency? Anybody? So isn't it strange that if we don't know anyone, does protein deficiency even exist? So, if protein deficiency doesn't exist, why are we running after proteins? Actually, you know, today we have diseases because of protein excess. Like, what is protein good for? Why do we want to or need to have a certain amount of protein? Why? Does anyone have an idea?
It's for the muscles, it's for hair, it's for everything.
It's for everything. And what does it do for everything?
Better
with proteins. So we've been told a lot of stuff, right? But we do know, you do know, because you have learned this in school. What is protein good for?
It increases metabolism, that's what people tell, because you get more muscles and you get more metabolism.
Right.
More at the cellular level.
Okay, so is horse a muscular animal?
Yes. Yes.
What kind of protein does horse have? Something like that, right? So where are we looking for the protein? I'm just putting the thoughts in your mind, like, because only if the questions come will the answers come. Because we're going around the in our lives without even getting the questions. Like, how much protein do I need? What is protein good for? Does anyone know what protein is good for? Okay, little bit they said bodybuilding. Actually, protein is the food for growth and repair. Now, how much growth do we want now? That's how much protein we should have. And repair, right? Today we have diseases of protein excess because cancer, for example, is a growth. And actually, the cause of cancer can be, cancer has many causes, but one of them is excess of protein. And therefore, cancer is more common in the countries which consume higher protein. For example, 1 in 4 people in the US have cancer. It's a bit less in India. because they consume more protein. And we have this idea that milk is good for you, right? And that's because when we were young, our mothers ran around us, making us drink glasses of milk. But if we go back to instinct, then every child, when it was first given cow's milk, said no. And this means something. And so the mothers, in order to push it down, add sugar or bornvita, I mean other things, which everybody knows are unhealthy, in order to push milk down, because the mothers think that it's essential. But if we were to just spend a minute to think about what milk is, then milk is the food that every mammal makes for its young. And we are not calves. So what are we drinking cow's milk? And in nature, no animal drinks another animal's milk. You don't find goats drinking pig's milk or monkeys drinking elephant's milk. So what are we doing drinking cow's milk, right? And of course, after the White Revolution, we've had more diseases than before. So it's something to think about. We've been taught that our canines prove that we're omnivores. I mean, never really think about this, but I want to show you the teeth of a carnivore and then the teeth of a herbivore. And now the teeth of omnivores. And now if you were to look at your own teeth, then you have to get some questions, right? Like, what are we really? Are we really carnivores or omnivores? And if we start thinking about this, then we'll get to know what is a natural food for our species. So I just want to connect you to our instincts. Just for a moment. So has anyone been to a farm or an orchard and seen fruits and vegetables hanging there? Who's seen that? Oh, that's lovely, because I see so many people who've never been. Okay, so if you see those fruits and vegetables hanging there, what do you feel like doing? Pluck. This is instinct. If you see the chicken walk by in the village, what do you feel like doing? Petting it, leaving it alone, taking a photograph like I did, whatever, but we don't usually chase and pounce and tear it apart and devour, right? But a dog would have the opposite reaction. Here, he would do nothing. But if he was taken to a chicken coop, maybe there would be some damage, right? So, but we have learned to eat chicken, and now if you smell that barbecue chicken, you might be tempted, because it's a habit that has been cultivated, just like milk. If I were to tell you not to consume any more milk if you wanted to get back your health, and if I were to say milk means milk, cheese, butter, curds, paneer, ice cream, buttermilk, whatever else, how would you feel? But remember that somebody had to train you in order for you to even accept it the first time. And manufacturers know this, because when they try to sell us products, body care products, they never smell of beef and chicken, right? So we already spoke about milk. Milk is the food that every mammal makes for its young. And we forget it when it comes to cows, just because the rest of the world is consuming cow's milk, right? So where do we get all these ideas from, that milk is good for you, or that we are omnivores, or whatever? Where do you get these ideas from? Passed on from generations, from our parents and grandparents. And
also the doctors.
And the doctors, who also get it from the same source.
Corporations.
Who, I just want to share with you an advertisement which you've probably already seen.
Neo Classical. Dood hai wonderful. Pee sakte hai rose glassful. Garmi mein daalo dood mein ice. Dood ban gaya very nice.
your daily once or twice. Mil jayega,
I just want to see what's unusual about this advertisement.
Be your glass of food.
Dude in every season. Be your dude for healthy reason. The whole game feels fit and fine. Geo game box 99.
Now got to have a boom,
boom, boom. Daro or much gaya show.
Give me more, give me more.
Give me more.
Because this is where we're being brainwashed, right? Now what's interesting about this advertisement? What a long ad, first. It costs a lot, right? It has an amazing tune that if you hear it twice, then it'll go on in your mind and that milk will go straight in. But it has no brand name. That means who is placing these ads? Who's brainwashing us? It's us. I mean, the government, whatever. And this is true all over the world. Like if you go to, this is in Ireland, but it has the symbol of the European Union, no brand name. If you go to the US, it's the same thing. You got those Got Milk ads and it's the same story. No brand name. So why are corporations, or why is our government doing this to us? It's an interesting question. If these are interesting questions, we'll answer them in the end. I just want to put the questions in your mind right now.
The government truly believes that this is good for the population.
Yeah. Government truly does what's good for us? Really? Like, really?
No, but there are, I think, yeah, I agree.
Yeah. Government does some good things.
Yeah, government does some. No, not all bad.
This is one of them.
Huh?
Sorry, I think this is well-intentioned.
But
definitely, I mean,
yeah,
I don't see a conspiracy behind these kind of things.
Okay. I just invite you to read a book, and it's called Mad Cowboy and No More Bull. Two books by Howard Lyman. Have you heard about this author? Howard Lyman is an American. He was a meat and dairy farmer until he got a very severe illness. And by chance, he recovered from that illness in the hospital and he started thinking about what was the cause of this illness. Because whenever we want to solve a problem, we need to look at what is the cause. And for example, I told you that Sharan's vision is diabetes-free India. And the reason people aren't getting better is because doctors usually advise them to stop the sugar, stop the carbohydrates, right? Stop the rice or whatever. But sugar is not the cause of diabetes. Does anyone have a relative or someone who has diabetes here? Okay, so lots. So you know, unfortunately, India's like that. So you know that they stop the sugar, they stop the carbohydrates, diabetes never gets better. Because what is the cause of diabetes? Insulin resistance or lack of insulin? And why did insulin resistance or lack of insulin occur? If you understand that, remove the cause, diabetes gone. But if we, high blood sugar is just the result of diabetes. And if we just work at the symptom, it's not going to get us anywhere. It's like having a car and that, you know, oil light comes on, starts blinking. And now you have two options. Cut off the wire or actually do something about the cause, right? And what we're doing in most situations is cutting off the wire. So how can we start thinking about what is the cause of disease? And of course, processed foods, that's like, I'm going to show you a video.
I have fries with it and it's aging better than me. Nothing, no preservatives, no shrink wrap. This is what a real potato looks like, sliced open, 3 months old. This is a McDonald's French fry that's 4 years old.
And you know, processed foods last for a really long time. I'm just going to take it to the point where she takes out the burger.
This is just a McDonald's Happy Meal hamburger. This is going on 4 years old. Now, I want you to look at it. and look for mold. It crumbles. The bun is falling apart. That's the worst thing happening to this. Look for mold, mildew, that stuff in the corner of the shower stall. Do you see anything?
Oh my gosh, that is so weird.
It's just hard. Touch it.
Oh, okay.
It's just hard to the touch, okay? The cheese is hard. The little hamburger bun is shrunken up. But there's no mold, no mildew, no visible signs of rot, age, breakdown, or anything. Now, do you eat fast food? You're young, you're thin.
Now, food is supposed to... I'm going to pass this. Food is supposed to get digested. But what will happen if we eat food that doesn't break down in the environment? Will it just add on to us? These are questions, you know. Actually, maybe I will show this. Have you heard of a film called Hungry for Change? Has anyone seen that? Shall I show you a trailer for that? That's a film made by people who have transformed their lives through food. And so you'll see people in their before and after shots. And it starts with Chris Carr. Have you heard of Chris Carr? Chris Carr has written Crazy Sexy Diet and Crazy Sexy Kitchen and whatever, Crazy Sexy Lifestyle. I forgot all those, but something like that. But she, at the age of 31, got cancer. And she actually reversed her cancer like many others without medicines and just with food. So I'll talk to you more about, if we have time, where you can get more information about how to reverse cancer. But cancer wouldn't even occur. I told you the connection between protein and cancer, and I'm coming to the calcium question. So when a lie is repeated often enough, it takes in our minds the form of truth. If we go on seeing those ads, and that's why I often tell people that if you really want to know what to eat, nobody's going to spend money telling you something that's already written in your instincts, which is why you don't see advertisements for carrots and cucumbers or oranges and apples. So if you really want to know what to eat, make a list of everything that's advertised and don't eat that. Because nobody needs, it's like if I were to go to the road and stand with a bag of bones, would I need to advertise to give them to dogs? They would just come, right? And actually you see this because if you go to the road, you have vendors selling fruits and vegetables and they never have a sign. But if it's milk or even chicken, it usually has a sign, a brand name, etc. So I'm just going to show you this.
Dear diary, today I feel very sad and I want to eat everything.
The problem is that we are not eating food anymore. We are eating food-like products. And they are adorned, they are made to look better and smell better so that people are attracted to them.
It's not your fault. You're programmed to put on fat whenever there is food available. But now there's a lot of food available, but it's the wrong kind.
Sugar is in everything. In America, we're eating about 22 teaspoons of sugar a day.
Even the milk hasn't escaped. So, let me just show you. One kid, just for 5 years of elementary school, sugar, just from milk.
You might as well be rolling up the kid's sleeves and putting in heroin, because it's the same.
The marketing essentially lies to you, because it presents you with the promise you're going to be sexy and popular and cool, but in reality, you're going to be obese and miserable and sick.
Nothing else does it in your brain quite like a diet cola. And that's because there's a deadly combination there of aspartame and caffeine.
I think most people believe the FDA actually has their own scientists that do this analysis, but then nothing could be further from the truth.
If I was in the food industry, what am I looking to do? I want to sell you more food.
They're into just selling a mind.
You can lose weight on a diet, but it's a little bit like borrowing from Peter to pay Paul. I mean, you can get 10 pounds off your body through sheer force, but you're going to have to pay back with interest.
People know this, so why are highly intelligent people not stopping? Because they don't know the nature of the trap.
The whole dieting paradigm is flawed.
I was 31 when I realized I don't know how to take care of myself and I am sick. So I had to go back and learn all the things that I wish I had known as a child.
I tried everything. I did witch doctors, I did mud baths, acupuncture, I did the lot. The one thing which I was really afraid to face up to was changing what I put into my mouth.
I've never heard of a raw food restaurant. Raw food, how do you cook raw food?
I thought vegan was a planet.
I was over 400 pounds, and I had very bad sleep apnea. I was borderline type 2 diabetic.
Cleansing and detoxification will make you lose weight, will make your eyes white, will make your skin glow.
Somebody's got beautiful skin. It invites us to a deeper understanding about what's going on inside their body.
What we're talking about is a real diet in the sense of what a species eats. When we get onto our real diet, we don't have to think about these things anymore.
What do you think the body's gonna do? It's not gonna reject this at all. It's gonna look and say, now I'm on board. Now you're good to me, let me shine for you.